risultati buoni. Questo dipende dalla loro esperienza precedente, quindi nel training viene fornito anche una parte del lavoro proprio per affrontare i problemi speciali di ragazzi che hanno particolari difficoltà dovute alla loro esperienza negativa.
I would like to continue a bit more about the question of measuring results. We all know it is very difficult. In the first lesson, you said people are exposed to 700 words. So the first part of my question is, what is the estimated exposure for the 4 weeks of the course? And then, have you measured results by comparing outcomes in public examinations with people who have taken longer, perhaps, to learn? So I appreciate that your method is concentrating on building up the passive repertoire so that people have the resource to draw on to be more creative in their communication. And so then we have the problem with measuring creativity.
No, not exactly. Shall I read the questions again? Because, yes. Okay, the first question, how do you measure, assess progress? How many words for a complete course of 80 hours of 4 weeks? And how do you assess the extent of learning, of real interiorization? Are there comparisons of results when students take public examinations?
I am working in this field about 40
in
years.
Italian, shall I? Can I translate the questions in Italian first? Excuse me.
Ah,
yeah, because I did. Allora, come si misura il si valuta il i, come si valutano i progressi ottenuti? A quante parole possono essere esposti gli allievi in un corso di 80 ore in 4 settimane? Quanto materiale? E come si valuta poi quanto si è appreso? E cosa possiamo fare quando gli allievi devono fare degli esami pubblici, dato che c'è una conoscenza passiva? Come questo poi si collega con l'affrontare un esame pubblico?
That's generally the problem of the testing. That is, in fact, the different variants of testing. I can say there are a lot of publications, but also all those years we did a lot of tests, not me, but many colleagues of mine. Also in some theses defended, it is that people are tested. Here was the problem, what kind of test to be applied. Some colleagues taught students stupidly, but tested them by some traditional tests only, where the tests are mostly in accordance to the method taught. That's why we have a lot of discussions and finally decide, okay, we test, for example, in Canada, in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the school where a group of teachers trained by us worked, and we have a trainer trained there. They, in the beginning, decided to test only by one or another. Okay, test both our tests, because our communicative tests are. But we have also the grammatical, lexical, everything we have, not only the communication, but on the basis of the communicative test, the level of the communication in normal life, we have also tests about the different elements. How do they know the grammar? How do they know the lexical units? Are they emotionally accepting the communication? Are they not disturbed? So, and we agreed to also apply your test, the public, the not, but the foreign, the minister, the School of the Foreign Ministry of Canada, Leo Boudreau. You know him, yes. He did it. He have some reports about the results there, and they tested by their tests, which are not connected with our method of teaching. Okay, you agreed because their tests are communicative, because they are teaching people working in the foreign ministry to go abroad to work with the language. And the test, of course, both tests are positive, accelerating the results a couple of times, 2-3 times. I believe he reported in Vienna about these things, before he reported in Victorberg about his experiments with these things. And applying those tests, always we had a better result than the control groups. It is almost very careful applying Cestopedia about the testing. Because the tests, if they are not connected, if they're not reflecting the way of teaching, in some respect could be not quite good. But the other test also can be applied if I'm taking into consideration that that's a communicative method. And we applied both tests, as I mentioned, okay, results are very good. In life, thousands of our students are after being taught they are abroad, they work with this language. Not only adults, also children. I told you we have thousands of children, 18 schools, and 20 more control schools for many years working, and they had, even now I met some students of mine, now they are adults, they have children now. They speak several languages, very good, applied in practice. No problems about the practical application, but in this respect also I have to tell, we had a difficult point in the beginning when we started. We noticed that after finishing the course and going abroad, some of the students had some problems because life abroad is not life in a classroom, not so soft, and people not so polite like the teacher. And that's why we adapt our second level course to be more near life. So one side they are learning so stupidically faster, another side they are adapted to the difficulties, the problems in life, when they speak with mistakes, and people are not so polite, but make some faces. Could you imagine, especially in Germany, you speak with mistakes in Germany. I don't speak in America, but in Germany, oh God. On the second word you speak with mistakes, they make a face, a mouth. They don't understand. They understand, they want to say correctly, exactly, the place, to the verb to be on the end, everything. And if you are students in a stupidical course, very soft, very polite, and going there very strong, oh God. You had such experiences some years ago, maybe 20 years ago, and that made us to change the second stage of training. So now we're having problems. People are applying the method very good abroad. Mm-hmm. No problems.
Allora, insegnando col metodo della suggestopedia, cosa succede quando abbiamo dei test che sono tradizionali? C'è stato questo esperimento in Canada dove entrambi i test sono stati effettuati a persone che avevano studiato l'insegnamento con la suggestopedia, quindi sia test sulla comunicazione, anche test sulla grammatica, sull'apprendimento del lessico e sul coinvolgimento emotivo. I risultati di entrambi i test sono stati positivi. C'è stata una persona di cui non ho capito il nome in Canada? Leo Boudreau, yes. Che ha fatto poi delle relazioni su appunto questi risultati positivi ottenuti sia con test di tipo tradizionale che con test di suggestopedia, e ha riportato questi risultati sia a Vienna che in Sudafrica. Certamente se il test non riflette l'insegnamento che è stato effettuato, il test, la verifica non può essere positiva. Però c'è anche stato un altro caso, quando l'insegnamento con il metodo della suggestopedia è stato effettuato in 18 scuole su centinaia di bambini, nell'applicazione pratica, cioè quando questi bambini sono poi andati a parlare in inglese nella vita reale, è successo che abituati ad un insegnamento in un ambiente che era molto accogliente, loro hanno avuto dei problemi invece quando sono stati trattati male nella vita reale, perché magari facevano degli errori, allora la gente rispondeva in maniera negativa. Allora questo ha fatto sì che si pensasse ad un adattamento, cioè nella seconda fase dell'apprendimento i ragazzi sono stati anche inseriti in contesti simulati in classe, dove loro affrontavano queste difficoltà della vita reale, perché certo nella vita reale è così, non sempre la situazione di classe poi la ritroviamo fuori.
mentioning about Canada, I would like to add, we had Italian course with Dr. Gatteva on 1994. And in this school, they have the best teachers chosen, specially selected. And they thought, okay, make an Italian course to compare. Okay, made. The difference was so tragical in supporting such stupidical method that they at once decided very, very soon to apply the method, in, especially in the French courses. The others, they have some financial condition, but the French, for the French languages, we started this time. And this time we make comparison between ours. They have in their library all the records of the tests of the students learning Italian earlier, all the years earlier learning. And now they compare to the test they did in their tests on the group of the Dr. Gatteva, you had in 1994. It was a dramatic difference. At once they decided to train teachers there and to apply the method in this school. But again, I'll tell that in the history of the stupidity we had some difficulties earlier, before the tests. That's why be careful if you test. It's important that tends to correspond to the method. Some methods are mostly translate on the translation, mostly to convert, to speak, different. Our method is adapted to all the requirements of foreign language. The passive and the active, not only the passive level to understand, to read, but also active to speak. And I can say there was an article published by a Russian professor, she died later, Professor Natalia Roshkova, I believe, no. Maybe but it is published in a journal. She, it was years ago, maybe 25 years ago, she compared, also in the university in Moscow, that is a special for pedagogical university for teaching language and so. Natalia, but I forgot now the family name. And she compared stupidical teaching with her. She had about maybe 40, 50 foreign language teachers. You know, in Moscow, very normally they have a lot of people there. And compared, at the first glance, she had the feeling that in stupidical people are doing, giving more mistakes like the other. At one case, they speak but with more mistakes. But she makes the calculations. What happened? Yes, stupidical students made more mistakes because they speak much more. In percent, they are less. They are free to speak. And they speak much more, speak, they want to express themselves. And when she calculated the percent, oh God, in fact, the percent of mistakes is less. Mm-hmm. You see, a lot of these things for us, it was interesting all this year to see how it happened. And now we know that it's okay, mistakes are doing also, they are doing mistakes, of course, in the beginning of the training. Later, the mistakes are diminished, normal, like the normal courses. Okay.
Nel 1994 la dottoressa Gatteva fu chiamata in una scuola.
Natalia Smirnova is her name. Excuse me.
Smirnova.
Smirnova, Natalia Smirnova. Mm-hmm. Her article is published.
Ok. quindi il primo esperimento è stato quello effettuato nel 1994, quando la dottoressa Gatteva fu chiamata in una scuola dove c'erano i migliori insegnanti, bravissimi insegnanti specializzati e formati, per paragonare i risultati nelle classi di apprendimento di lingua francese. E loro hanno anche usato i loro test per verificare i risultati. La differenza è stata, come si dice in inglese, bellissimo, drammatica. La differenza tra i risultati raggiunti con i metodi tradizionali e quelli raggiunti con i metodi della Suggestopedia. Tuttavia, il professore invita ad essere molto attenti a usare dei test che corrispondono al metodo. Il secondo esperimento è quello effettuato dalla professoressa Natalia Smirnova all'Università di Mosca nel Dipartimento di Lingue Straniere.
Pedagogical Institute. University with the name Pedagogical Institute.
Il nome dell'università è questo istituto pedagogico. Lei paragonò i risultati raggiunti dopo il primo corso di Suggestopedia e riscontrò che gli alunni del corso di Suggestopedia facevano più errori, ma facevano più errori perché parlavano molto di più degli alunni che provenivano da un corso con gli insegnamenti di tipo tradizionale. E quindi sì, accettiamo anche più errori se parlano in maniera in percentuale gli errori erano minori dato la quantità di speaking che riuscivano a fare.
You know, yes.
Okay, I've got two questions. We usually have got very big classes, 25 students maybe. Is it possible to realize Suggestopedia in big, very big contexts? And another one is, how can we avoid shyness? Because students may be shy to sing, they don't want to sing. They prefer to to remain. Mm-hmm. How can we, is there something we can do to avoid shyness? Thank you.
Abbiamo di solito delle classi molto numerose, di media 25 allievi. Come è possibile realizzare l'uso della Suggestopedia in classi così con un grosso numero di allievi? E, qual è il miglior modo di far stare seduti, di sistemare gli allievi in una classe quando ci sono così tanti alunni? E poi a volte gli alunni sono anche timidi, non vogliono cantare. O non vogliono partecipare ad attività creative. Come possiamo evitare questa timidezza degli allievi?
We had this problem many times about the size of the group. We have a tragical moment in America some years ago, 1979 in San Francisco. The Americans gave us a group of 27. Dr. Gatev asked me, what shall I do, 27 people? Because American was taking money from everyone taking part in the course. They wanted to have more people, more money. They didn't think about the work. But what to do? We had to work. In America, journalists are coming to observe, taking pictures, a lot of things. Yet we did it. Of course, the results are very good, but of course, because one cannot communicate individually with 27 people every day. They weren't the best. Good enough, but not the best. The best results we receive with groups between 5 and 12. More, but of course in the school, with children we have 27, 30 children in the school. Yes, we work. Good results, not the best, but good. Yes, that is. The size is important. I know that it's not very easy to change the size because the schools have some rules. You can keep them. Okay. Now, for example, in Japan, there are some colleagues of mine working in Japan. They also sometimes have very big groups there. And of course, better, but not the best results. Mm-hmm. One must be flexible. The other question about the shine students. Oh, yes, that's what I said in the beginning. Students can take part if they want. If they don't, they can sit down and observe. And what happens normally? They sit down and observe at once spontaneously, they include and take part. Because they see nothing bad. Why not to sing together, to play together with them? But they are permitted to do as they want. The teacher is giving example. The teacher is playing together with the students. And they see if the teacher can play, if the teacher can sing, why not there? And of course, the playing, the singing are not to disturb their moral structure, their moral vision, not to destroy their understanding of the morality. They are very normal. Nothing, no any sexual elements, no anything, only like childish sometimes. And they sit down some minutes and include themselves. That's why we're proceeding with this shining. They sit down and they decide to come or not.
Riguardo alla prima domanda dei gruppi numerosi, c'è stato proprio una volta negli Stati Uniti nel 1979 a San Francisco al dottor Lozano e alla dottoressa Gatteva è stato presentato un gruppo di 27 allievi e c'erano anche i giornalisti a verificare i risultati di questa classe. In un gruppo così numeroso i risultati sono buoni, non sono certamente i migliori risultati, perché non è possibile con un gruppo di 27 persone comunicare ogni giorno con ciascun allievo. L'optimum del gruppo è da 5 a 12 allievi, con questo numero di allievi si raggiungono i migliori risultati. Nelle classi normali non si raggiungeranno i migliori risultati con tutti gli allievi, ma i risultati saranno comunque buoni. Questa è la situazione per esempio in Giappone, dove ci sono delle classi molto numerose. Riguardo alla timidezza, gli alunni devono essere lasciati liberi di partecipare alle attività oppure no. Se gli si permette di non partecipare, poi parteciperanno. E comunque è molto importante il ruolo dell'insegnante. L'insegnante deve dare l'esempio. Se l'insegnante canta insieme agli allievi, anche gli allievi cantano. E deve essere una cosa normale, non ci deve essere costrizione, perché la costrizione distrugge la motivazione.
Una domanda su che cosa succede in una classe suggestopedica, su cosa non succede, o altrimenti su cosa può succedere e non può succedere. Premessa, come abbiamo visto, il ruolo dell'insegnante è molto forte, sia in senso, diciamo, fisico, sia nel senso del suo ruolo come conduttore, course designer, programmatore, eccetera. Chiedo al dottor Lozano, che ne è dell'autonomia dello studente in due sensi? Sono previsti, ammessi percorsi alternativi di apprendimento allo script fornito dal text, dal manuale? Uno, percorsi alternativi, diciamo, suggeriti, per usare un termine, dagli studenti medesimi? E numero due, è prevista una interazione fra studenti che lascia in secondo piano l'insegnante, cioè dove l'insegnante sta da una parte e sono gli insegnanti, gli studenti con interazioni autonome che si confrontano e via dicendo. Grazie.
Ok, the idea is starts from the role of the teacher. The role of the teacher is central to the application of this method. So what about the student's autonomy? Is there a time when the student can suggest an alternative activity or routine, alternative to the one that is offered by the textbook? And also, is there a phase when the teacher is not in the center of the stage, but the students are central and they conduct? Is that correct?
Yeah. Okay. Here is one of the biggest mistakes done by the traditional pedagogy. That's why in some schools introducing basically correct idea to have the freedom of the children, the results are in many schools very bad. We have the same idea, the freedom of the students and the children. But I mentioned here using classical art. The classical art is keeping in some way the discipline in the order in the classroom. But that is not the whole answer of your question. The direct answer is the following. The teacher, as you saw here, is not such a leader, such a dominated. Even the students are taking part from the introduction, they discuss with the teacher, during the session they co-create with him the session. But that is the first day. The second day, during the elaboration, the teacher is aside. The teacher is only like advisor if they need some questions. They play some games alone without the teacher. But he is or she is there. If they need some question, they can ask. So they are absolutely free in this time. But in the same time, They must follow the program. They don't know the subject. How to give them full freedom to, for example, you're teaching now present continuous tense. They want to learn other things. It will be a big chaos. That's why they know that they are studying by the knowledgeable teacher. They have freedom to do everything. They could ask questions outside the subject discussed, but the answer is very short. Not to lose time and losing the logic of the science. The teachers are answering. They ask, what is the okay? And they are again coming to the program. So one side, they have the freedom. They have the freedom to ask questions and to go in other areas, other than the areas in the moment to be discussed. But in the same time, they must keep the program what to be discussed, because there is a logic of the science. If they create chaos, they won't learn anything. They must keep some order. That's why both things, one side having freedom, other side keeping the program. That is this again dual approach in the teaching.
Ci sono entrambi gli aspetti nell'insegnamento con la Sagestopedia. Prima di tutto c'è l'idea che l'arte classica porta l'ordine e la disciplina. Completa libertà di scelta da parte degli studenti sarebbe il caos. Tuttavia, nella Sagestopedia l'insegnante non è un leader che domina. Nella fase dell'elaborazione l'insegnante si mette da parte e lascia liberi gli studenti di giocare, di fare le attività, ma è lì quando gli studenti la vogliono. Lei è lì per rispondere a tutte le domande che loro vogliono fare. C'è il programma da seguire. Il programma della Sagestopedia è un programma che ha è un progetto logico. Bisogna seguire questo programma. All'interno del programma ci sono i momenti e le fasi in cui gli studenti prendono il sopravvento rispetto all'insegnante, che tuttavia è sempre lì per indicare la direzione ed è disponibile quando gli studenti vogliono fare le domande.
I ought to add only one word more. There is a teacher, I don't say the name and the country, who is teaching pretending stupidically, but she is teaching this way. One, two, three, listen, here, listen, repeat please. And she is claiming that is the stupidity. No such command is stupidity. That is on the opposite. But she is claiming that she teaches the stupidity and there are people who are trained by her. But what to do? Freedom of personality.
L'esempio di questo insegnante è un insegnante che pretende di essere un insegnante di Sagestopedia, ma questo tipo di insegnante che ha fatto il professor Lozanov è solo una pretesa, non è questo un insegnante di Sagestopedia. Cosa devo fare con queste domande? Devo tradurle e leggerle. Ok, potrebbe spiegare meglio le varie attività, fasi di una unità didattica. Abbiamo visto soltanto la presentazione e cantare insieme. E poi quali sono le attività attraverso le quali viene presentata e prodotta la lingua scritta? Ok, can you explain the various phases of a Sagestopedic unit, various activities? We have only seen the presentation phase and singing together. And then another question, what are the activities that we can use to present and produce written language?
I don't know if I understood correctly the questions.
But
I try, if not correct, I...
Shall I say it again in other words?
Yeah, I guess, mm-hmm. Repeat again.
Okay, we have, in the video, we have seen the presentation of material,
yes.
And also activities of singing activities.
Follow one element, of course.
Perhaps we want some more examples of other activities. Would that be okay? No? The stages, yes, the faces of the concert.
Under faces, you understand stages.
Stages.
Okay.
L'unità didattica è, voglio dire, no, no, non so se ha a che fare con la Sagestopedia. L'unità didattica ha a che fare con la Sagestopedia. No. Okay, yes. If when we have a teaching unit,
yeah.
What are the stages of suggestopedia within a teaching unit?
May I answer the first question, then the second question.
The second question is, what are the best activities to have the students produce writing?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I couldn't show you all of the stages of the method because that's taking a lot of time. And I had to choose optimum explanations and showing some elements. But I said there is a stage of introduction. You saw some part of it, where the teacher is starting communicating with the students, even they in the beginning don't understand, but step by step they start repeating, start answering. The introduction, with using different objects. After that there is a stage of conversation, and where the teacher is reading with music, different ways and so. But after that I mentioned there is a 1 or 2 days, depends on the lesson, elaboration. Elaboration is to be applied with a lot of games. There are hundreds of games. And with these games, the teacher is activating the material already taught. Different variants, different possibilities, because you know, speaking a language is not so to be programmed, only one, so monotonous questions and answers. And that is done during the elaboration. And during the elaboration, the students are more free to ask questions, to do a lot of things. They are happy, they are active, and so. But the whole process is to be seen if only the whole training course, which can last 1 month. Because the activities the first day are different than the second day. The activities during the first lesson are different than the third and the fourth lesson. Depends on the problems to be learned. But I only gave some small ideas. In principle, what is it? That is a development. Introduction, conversation, elaboration. Introduction, you have some small, not only singing, there are a lot of other things, speaking, discussing, some cultural problems, but if I put to see everything, we have to stay 2 hours more here. And also, after that here the session, I wanted to show you, but elaboration is longer. There are a lot of games. You won't be able to see all of them here. That is the stages. Of course, you won't be able in this short seminar to receive all of the impressions you would like to have them. Not possible. Time is short. Even my theoretical explanations were very shortened. I had to cut a lot of things. Normally, I give during the training courses. I had to cut because I must think about the time. But that is the stages. And the second question was about
writing.
Writing. For us, reading and writing is not difficult because we start reading spontaneously on the first day, on the fifth or the second day, they start reading. But writing, we don't teach writing during the first level course. Writing is to be taught on the second level course. After having habits to read, after having already a lot of impressions about the words, then they start writing. And again, nothing special in the writing. Very normal, they dictate, they write some letters and so in the classroom, but that's the second level course. No any special procedure, only like reading, they read, you see even now during the session, they read together with the teacher in spite of they didn't know English before. But that is an imitation. They imitate together with the teacher and step by step they start being aware. And after a couple of days, they start reading new lessons already. Of course, some mistakes with the new words, but till the end of the course they start reading without doing mistakes. Similar is with writing, but the second level course. Mm-hmm. That's what you're doing, no any special okay. procedures.
Riguardo alle fasi, stages, ci sono 3 fasi. C'è la prima fase di introduzione, durante la quale gli allievi cominciano a fare delle attività, cominciano a ripetere, è più una fase di presentazione del materiale. Poi c'è la concert session, la fase del concerto, e poi c'è la fase di elaborazione, durante la quale gli allievi fanno centinaia di giochi. lavorano su materiale per fare l'attivazione di quanto è stato appreso in maniera passiva durante la fase del concerto. Gli studenti sono più liberi, sono attivi, sono felici, fanno molte attività orali, molte discussioni, ci sono anche delle sessioni su argomenti culturali. Ci sono migliaia di attività. Certo, non è possibile in un evento di questo genere far vedere tutte le attività e tutte le fasi, questo viene fatto durante la formazione. Per quanto riguarda le attività di writing, non è difficile per gli alunni in un corso di suggestopedia scrivere, perché loro leggono molto fin dall'inizio, quindi inizialmente leggono per imitazione degli insegnanti, certamente possono fare degli errori quando incontrano parole nuove. Ma nel primo livello non c'è lo scritto di tipo, non c'è la produzione scritta. Questa viene fatta nel secondo livello attraverso attività normalissime di dettato, lettere, tutte le attività che normalmente si usano per produrre il writing.
Parlo in italiano o in inglese? Solo volevo chiedere gentilmente di ripetere un attimino la differenza tra i due concerti attivo e passivo, the differences between the active and passive concert and the different functions of the two concerts. And the other question was about suggestion and desuggestion, if you could repeat the problem of desuggestion a little bit, help us to see the difference between these two processes. Spiegare un po' le differenze tra i due processi di suggestione e desuggestione. Grazie.
Active and passive consent. No, she said it.
If I understood correctly, if not, ask me again. The passive concert session is nothing special. Reading absolutely normally, on the background music from pre-classic. Nothing special in the intonation, only reading normal. On the background is going Bach or other pre-classic, specially selected in our program. That's why I didn't lose time to show normal reading. That is about the passive session. But the active and the passive session have different functions. And they are always together, not to be divided. I want to underline this, because some colleagues working in the Suggestopedia, they divide. Today active, tomorrow the passive. They must be together. During the active session, the students are reading the textbook. They can take notes. That's why active. They can take notes in the books, some question marks there. That is during the active session. During the passive, the books are closed. They only listen normal language. And of course, we must finish always with the passive, because the active is not giving them the normal language. They finally must hear the normal language. That's why they must hear finally the passive. But the passive is very short, about 10 till 15 minutes, even 10 minutes. Even during the passive session, some part can be shortened. That is the function, the passive and the active session. About the other,
Suggestion.
I gave some example. Maybe I wasn't quite clear. We, in our theory, but I think not all, I think other scientists think about. We have more possibilities that you are activated in our everyday life, but they are pressed. They are limited by the everyday suggestions from the school, family. Why? How, for example, children are going to the school. They're giving a textbook. In this textbook, they have small lessons. If they are given two lessons, oh, it is too much for them. They are already suggested. It is too much to have two or three lessons, not possible. Three lessons. But for us, three lessons are nothing. We give 10 or 15 lessons, because from the beginning. But in the school, the size of the books and the lessons are suggesting children, because the books are coming from the authority, from the ministry, from the knowledgeable people, from the teachers. People with high prestige, you know that prestige is suggesting. And these suggestions are limiting children. They believe that only this thing they can learn without destroying their health and being able to memorize. That they are already limited. They have only suggestion limiting their activities. Similar things are also in the family. But if you remember how children are learning their normal language as a children, no any limitations. They hear how their parents are speaking day and night. They hear. Nobody says, okay, stop speaking because it is too much to hear. The parents are speaking constantly. And the children are hearing, no problems. But later when they start learning, they are limited. And that is creating such limitations. And we believe, okay, we can make the children free from these limitations created by the school, by the society, because not only this, there are many, many other reasons to be limited. And that is their suggestion. They are suggested. That is social suggestive norms. The social suggestion, the society, the whole organization of society is suggesting that is the limit. That is what they can do. And we say, okay, we can make them free to do more. Two ways. One, to insist. You can. The other is to start spontaneously speaking to them like we believe they can, without insisting. That is an absolutely new development. And they at once, I can. They start speaking. That is their suggestion. Without using much the suggestive power of insisting, of repeating, and much intonating, in spite of, as I mentioned, some influences are not to be avoided. They are constantly existing. We take in account this. But we don't rely on their very much concentration, but we rely mostly on the conversation, on the edge, on the border of their believing system and on their knowledge. That is using the suggestive possibilities, making them free without pressing, spontaneity. I believe, if I'm not clear, you can ask again.
Okay. Riguardo ai due concerti, il concerto attivo e il concerto passivo sono diversi, hanno funzioni diverse, anche procedure di lavoro diversi. Una cosa è molto importante, che siano sempre eseguiti insieme, il concerto attivo e il concerto passivo. Nel concerto attivo gli alunni hanno il testo davanti e quindi loro annotano sul testo quello che vogliono sapere dall'insegnante o le loro impressioni, le loro sensazioni. Lavorano attivamente con il loro testo che viene letto dall'insegnante. Nel concerto passivo non c'è più il testo, ma c'è una lettura a velocità normale con musica classica, Bach o altro di sottofondo. Il concerto passivo è molto veloce, rapido, non dura più di 10 minuti. La sessione del concerto finisce con il concerto passivo ed è una cosa molto breve. È passivo, per cui segue il concerto attivo, perché gli alunni devono essere in grado già di avere una comprensione autonoma di quello che viene letto. Per quanto riguarda la differenza tra suggestion e desuggestion, tutta la società, la famiglia e anche l'ambiente scolastico fanno delle pressioni sugli allievi, i libri, il prestigio degli insegnanti suggeriscono che ci sono dei limiti per gli alunni, quello è il limite, anche lo stesso modo di dire agli alunni tu lo puoi fare, tu lo devi fare, suggerisce che c'è un limite. Desuggestion significa rendere l'alunno libero di fare in base al suo potenziale. C'è una certa influenza che l'insegnante esercita, ma questo si fa attraverso attività comunicative, attraverso la conversazione, attraverso il gioco, e quindi c'è l'idea proprio di liberarci dei limiti che l'esperienza ha indotto a credere che abbiamo.
Ok, ci sarebbe, si potrebbe andare avanti ore col professor Lozano, ma credo che ormai siamo tutti quanti anche un po' stanchi, quindi io ringrazierei il professor Lozano per questo suo seminario di 2 giorni in cui veramente abbiamo imparato tante cose. E non so se sia stato un seminario suggestopedico, ma sicuramente abbiamo imparato molto sulla suggestopedia in generale. Quindi grazie al professor Lozano. E poi vorrei invitare qua vicino tutta l'organizzazione, la Elena, Renata e tutti quanti gli altri ragazzi, e vorrei che faceste un grosso applauso anche a loro. Chiaramente anche le traduttrici e le interpreti. E grazie da parte nostra a voi per essere venuti a Venezia, e di nuovo grazie anche da Ca' Foscari per l'ottima accoglienza su questo seminario. Speriamo di poter continuare a trattare questi argomenti anche col professor Lozano in seguito. Abbiamo capito che c'è questo grosso bisogno di formazione e di certificazione della formazione, e chissà, forse potremo anche cercare di, le intenzioni ci sono, di andare avanti e portare avanti questo discorso come Ca' Foscari Venezia insieme al professor Lozano. Grazie di nuovo a tutti. Thank you very much.